Assalamu alaikum rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. In this episode, we shall just witness the young Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the next bit of information we have was the first job of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Hadith is in Bukhari, so it is completely authentic. Allah never sent a prophet except that he was a shepherd." So they said, "Not even you, O messenger of Allah." So he said, "Yes, I was a shepherd, and I used to tend to the flock of the people of Makkah in return for some pennies." Why would Allah do this? If Allah had willed, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have been born in the lap of luxury. Sheep are very similar to men in that they need to be taken care of, and else they are going to go astray. And every single animal has a personality, and the shepherd understands this personality, and that you need to treat every animal according to that animal's personality. Some sheep are stubborn, some are soft, and some are gentle. Some they know where they are going, others they follow the pack. Some are the leaders, some are not. So the shepherd gets to understand each and every sheep in the flock, and he deals with every animal according to its personality. And this is what a leader needs to do, and this is what a prophet of Allah needs to do, that they need to deal with every person according to their personality and according to their nature, behavior. Every animal according to its personality. And in another few years, even a more famous incident occurred, and this is called the Pact of Fudul, or the Pact of Mutayyabin. The Prophet maybe is probably in his early 20s. What happened was, a person from the tribe of Zubayd, and Zubayd is a tribe in Yemen. So the Ammonites, when you are in Makkah, the people did not consider this tribe to be as elite. They are a low caste tribe, and they are very far away. So when you are far away, what this means is you don't have people willing to fight for you, right? So what happens? This person from the tribe of Zubayd sold an item before Hajj. He has come as a merchant. He has brought his leather. He has brought his good. That's how you get your money. And he sold a number of items to Al-As ibn Wail. Al-Asaid Wail, the father of Amr ibn Al-As. And Al-As ibn Wail, he is Chephitine. He is politician. He is a career statesman in the Quraysh. And he is a rich businessman. He sold it to him before Hajj. And Al-Asaid, "I will give you the money. Yes, I will give you the money after Hajj before you go back to Yemen. Come to me after and I will give it to you." So he goes, "Okay, fine. I can't wait that long. I don't need it now. I need it back in Yemen." So he performs the Hajj, and then he says, "I need my money." Allah says, "Come back tomorrow." So he comes back tomorrow. And Allah says, "Come back tomorrow again." He come back tomorrow, and then he continues doing this until he realizes that he is not going to get that money. So this person goes to the other sub-tribes, and everyone makes an excuse. Why? Because Al-As ibn Wail is a politician, he is rich, he is a leader, and therefore feeling completely trapped. And obviously not having any other outlet, he decided to make this a public issue. What did they do in those days? They would write poems. And so one day, when everybody is in front of Kaaba, which is basically everybody would gather there every day, or gather around Asr time, all the people of Makkah would now come and they would sit. This is a social place as well. He now comes and he says out loud his poem that he has compiled. So he says, "O tribe of fear, O Quraysh," and he made everybody listen his story. So the news spread like wildfire, and Az-Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's elder uncle, Az-Zubayr ibn Abdul Muttalib heard of this, and he said, "We have to do something about this." this is not going to go on anymore. And he convinced a gathering of all of the senior members of the Quraysh in the house of somebody whose name you should memorize. He comes up in Sirah over and over again. Abdullah ibn Judan, and here he is where they agreed to a pact, a treaty. They would side with the oppressed against the oppressor regardless of which tribe the oppressor belonged to. And they said even if the one who is shown injustice is from a far away tribe and the oppressor is from a Quraysh sub-tribe, we will side with the one who has been oppressed and we will get his full rights from the oppressor. And they all went in front of the Kaaba and they publicly announced this and they signed their names on a document. Now there is no document, there was no signature. So what do you do in those days? You dip your hands in perfume in front of Kaaba and you put that perfume on the Kaaba on the same place. Everybody puts it on the same place. And the Prophet said, hadith is in Sahih Bukhari. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I witnessed in the house of Abdullah ibn Judan a treaty that where I asked to uphold it. Even in Islam, I would do so. If I were to be asked to follow the treaty even now, I would do so. And I would not be willing to give up my place for a lot of red camels. Meaning if you were to tell me, if you were give me a lot of money and I were not present at that treaty, I would not do so. I would not be willing to do so. In that treaty, he is saying, they all agreed that the rights would be given back to the ones who deserve them and no oppressor would have the upper hand over the one who has oppressed. This is the beautiful teaching of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now in next episode we will see how Khadija radiyallahu ta'ala anha proposes the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Till that time, like, share and subscribe this channel. Thank you very much.